First Baptist. I'm Mike.
And I'm Abby, and we are so glad to have you here.
I want to invite all the men in our church to the men's prayer breakfast next Saturday, 7 a.m. in the Fellowship Hall. Now, I know you're going to be hungry, so come join us for a giant breakfast and a devotion led by Bruce Harless.
The whole family is invited to our Chiefs tailgate party on October 16th at 2 p.m.
Super fun.
It'll be in the Esquire parking lot. We'll have food and games before we move inside to watch a game on the big screen.
On the big screen.
Yeah,
yes, you bet. Hey, also, mark your calendars now for Sweets and Treats on October 31st. We are accepting candy donations, and we need a lot, so donate soon.
Yeah, and this Saturday, we'll be hosting our very first Apologetics mini-conference.
Man, that is going to be a great event. This mini-conference will equip us to lovingly engage our community and culture with the truth of God's Word, which is exactly what we want to do.
And this is a special one-day conference right here at First Baptist Bolivar. Anyone can attend. It will begin at 8:30 a.m. with a continental breakfast and a time of worship.
That's right. That's going to be a good time.
Yes.
Then we're going to move in for some morning sessions, a lunch all together, and then afternoon sessions, which will wrap up around 5 p.m.
Yeah, but you do need to register for this event. The mini conference costs $8 per person, which includes your breakfast, lunch, and a book by our keynote speaker, Dr. Bob Stewart.
That's right. That's right. So to sign up, simply go to our website, fbcbolivar.org, or there's a QR code on the worship guide that will take you right to that sign up form. Now, we really hope you'll join us for this special event.
If this is one of your first times worshiping with us, we invite you to text the word guest to 417-282-8322, or you can visit one of the info hubs after the service, where we'd love to meet you and help you get more connected to First Baptist Bolivar. Have a great day.
Have a great day.
Smithville, Missouri is a special location. Our Baptist home for the Missouri Baptist Convention, the director, Rodney Harrison, asked me to go to lunch. And while at lunch, he pitched the idea that they were going to establish a Baptist home there in Smithville, but it was going to be purely for veterans, and that there was a large space underneath the Baptist home there. And in that space, they had the intention of planting a church.
When I was given this idea, I said 100% yes. I was flat out for it because I could see the vision and I could see the end result. Veterans are very, they need somebody they can trust. And just to have that trust, they can open up and tell you how they're feeling, that's really big to me. In the United States right now, we have around 18 million veterans. In Missouri alone, we have around 425,000 veterans.
The church being planted is for veterans, whether they are in that Baptist home or not. A lot of them may be in the community, but when they know there's a church that fits their affinity, they're going to want to come and be a part of that. And that's our desire. This church got started because Missouri Baptist, all over the state, sacrificially prayed and gave that ultimately this church plant could take place.
When you have Christ, you have hope. Because mostly when you lose hope, then you've lost it all. But in Christ, there's everything. So the church being here, like I mentioned before, will be very unique. And the unique part is the veterans will have a full-time pastor and or a chaplain there available that whenever they need help, either spiritual help or emotional help, just someone to talk to or say, you know, I'm feeling like this, there's someone there for them all the time.
I look forward to seeing what God's going to do, and especially that one day in heaven, I will see other veterans who came to Christ because this church was planted.
Good morning. Welcome to First Baptist Bolivar. We're so glad you're here today. We want to welcome those who are watching online or listening on the radio as well. If this is one of your first times worshiping with us, we'd invite you to text the word guest to the number on the screen, 417-282-8322. Where after the services, we have tables in our lobbies. They're called the Info Hub, and there's someone there who would love to meet you and help you get more connected with First Baptist Bolivar. We have the honor and the joy of having the SBU Chorale under the direction of Dr. Alex Favaza here with us today. What a joy it is to worship with them. Know that this church may not know you personally yet, but we have been praying for you as students in the university. We know the challenges you're going through, and we are right here if you ever need us. We're glad you're here to sing with us today. Thank you, Dr. Favaza. Let's begin with a reading from God's Word, Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men. Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. For this reason also, God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee will bow, of those who are in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and that every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let's stand together as we sing hymn 456, How Firm a Foundation.
I was 7 years old at Falls Creek Camp, and I got saved. My dad helped me to understand what it means to become a Christian. We have sinned, and that will lead us away from God. I want to be with God because I love him. I believe in Jesus, that he died on the cross for our sins, and that he rose again. God saves us, and nothing else saves us but God. I want to be baptized to show people that I believe Jesus.
Sophia, are those your words?
Yes.
Have you believed that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins and was raised again by God that you might have eternal life?
Yes.
And do you commit today before the church and before God himself that you will trust and obey Jesus for the rest of your life?
Yes.
Well, church family, I come to baptize my daughter, Sophia Joy Wiese, who is indeed a joy. This is today what I would consider Sophia's first act of evangelism. She is letting the church know and everyone here that Jesus has saved her. He can save you too. If you have not trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ, that he died on the cross for your sins and was raised again, you too can be saved. We encourage you, believe in the Lord. And one last thing I'll say. I believe that when the age comes, when the faith becomes sight, that we will share stories of the great things that God has done. And I think that we will remember together the day that Sophia was baptized, when her great faith journey began. So let's baptize you. Okay? Based on your public profession of faith, and with great joy, I baptize you, Sophia Wiese, my daughter and now my sister in the faith, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism, raised to walk in the newness of life.
Let's continue worship by standing together as we sing Living Hope.
Mm-hmm. Let us bow and give thanks for this day. Let's take it to the Lord. Lord Jesus, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your many blessings. We're thankful for this world you have created and the universe you have created. Today we come and we praise you. We thank you for your benevolent, unconditional love and grace. Please bless this offering and tithes and take it for your use in your world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
they are continuing to exit, would you join me in thanking them one more time and celebrating what the Lord is doing through their ministry? As we continue our Anchored in Christ series, would you join me in Hebrews chapter 7? Hebrews chapter 7, and we are going to look together at all 28 verses today. As you turn there, let me take just a moment and remind you, as I did last week, of our Apologetics mini-conference that's coming up next Saturday, October the 1st. I know you heard about it and saw it again in the announcement video, but I just want to tell you one more time that this is the last week to register, so if you'd like to come, you may want to do that this week. Again, that's just an opportunity, and hopefully that's what it is just an opportunity to learn to defend and stand on in the world what we believe and teach in here. With that in mind, let's do what is our normal practice, and that's turning our attention to God's Word again together today, Hebrews chapter 7. It probably will not surprise you to hear me say there's been instances in my life, more than one, more than just a few, in which I have found myself feeling completely inadequate, almost hopeless, or no possibility that success could come from this situation. One of those instances come to mind, if we have any Hebrew professors in the room, would probably be my first day of Hebrew grammar when I was a master's student. Just knew there was no opportunity for success from that point forward. So several of you have never had Hebrew. I get that. I understand. But if you had, you'd know exactly what I meant. Another instance was when I was with my grandfather when I was about 5 years old. He was a farmer. We were driving through one of the fields that he farmed, and there was a large brush fire. And I remember him just jumping out of the truck and rushing into the fire to help those try to put it out. And I was just there left by myself and just wondering if I would ever see my grandfather again. I mean, I remember feeling like that in that moment. And I completely felt inadequate and hopeless in that moment. But I would tell you perhaps the greatest moment of inadequacy I've ever felt is that small window of time between when I really felt the weight of my sin and its consequences on my shoulder, and knowing there was nothing I could do about it on my own, and the period of time it took me to place saving faith in Jesus, and that Jesus relieved my burden of sin. That's probably the moments in which I felt the most inadequate in this life. How about you? You ever been there? Perhaps maybe just related to things in life, maybe related to spiritual matters. Just in the moment, you felt like there's nothing I can do to bring about success, whatever that might be in this moment. One scholar actually gave this quote that I think goes a long way to help us make sense of this. He said, "Any longing for God is an expression of our deep desire for completeness." In other words, we understand the completeness of God, and we understand we are not the perfection of God, and we long for that completeness in our own existence so that we can be with Him and be in relationship. With that in mind, I think we could look and could all agree that religion, man-made religion, is really just man's attempt somehow on our own to meet that desire for completeness. Man-made religion, in its basic derivative, is man's attempt to gain access to the divine, to God. But the truth of the matter is, do we need something different? Do we need something better? Do we need a better hope? And the question is, what is it? Where is it? And how do we find it? Well, Hebrews 7, and looking at, if I can say it this way, the priesthood of Jesus in our life goes a long way to show us this picture of this better hope. And so I want us to look together today, and really we begin in verses 1 through 10 with this understanding that we need, as people, a perpetual priesthood. Listen to verses 1 through 10. "For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham as he was returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him, to whom also Abraham apportioned a tenth part of all the spoils, was first of all, by the translation of his name, king of righteousness, and then also king of Salem, which is king of peace. Without father, without mother, without genealogy, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like the Son of God, he remains a priest perpetually. Now observe how great this man was to whom Abraham, the patriarch, gave a tenth of the choicest spoils. And those indeed of the sons of Levi who received the priest's office have commandment in the law to collect a tenth from the people, that is, from their brethren, although these are descendants from Abraham. But the one whose genealogy is not traced from them collected a tenth from Abraham and blessed the one who had the promises. But without any dispute, the lesser is blessed by the greater. In this case, mortal men receive tithes, but in that case, one receives them of whom it is witnessed that he lives on. And so to speak, through Abraham, even Levi, who received tithes, paid tithes. For he was still in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. In this portion of Scripture, the author of Hebrews returns us back to this idea of Jesus' priesthood, which, if I can say it this way, becomes the foundation for the doctrine and teaching that the entire book of Hebrews is based on. He returns us to this Melchizedekian priesthood that he first raised in chapter 5. And in order to understand what it is that he's saying about Jesus and the priesthood we have in him, we need to understand a very quick Old Testament history lesson. You see, in Genesis chapter 14, verses 17 through 20, Abraham had gone to war against the kings of the east to help his nephew Lot escape. Now, I will tell you, I pray to the Lord that I don't have a nephew like Lot, because it seems like every time Abraham turned around, in some ways Lot was a thorn in his side, but Abraham was a good uncle and tried all he could to help that young lad. And so Abraham goes to war against the kings of the east to deliver him, and he has success. And on his way back, he meets this mysterious figure named Melchizedek. Genesis does not mention him before. Genesis does not mention him afterwards. Just four verses. Now, we can say it a little bit more. We don't know where he came from or where he went. He was there, and all of a sudden, he was gone. But what's fascinating is Abraham gives him a tenth of what he had collected in war, and Melchizedek blesses Abraham. There are a few things just so quickly, ever so quickly, we can say we know about Melchizedek that stands out. First of all, simultaneously, which is very unique in the Old Testament, this man held both the office of priest and king. Amongst the people of God, that just really never happened. But he had both of those offices. We also know that he, by his name, was a king of righteousness. That's loosely translated what his name means. But by the location that he served, Salem, he was the king of peace. That's what Salem means. So he was the king of righteousness and the king of peace. But what the author points out the most here, or the most significantly, is that Melchizedek doesn't seem to have a genealogy. There's no mother or father mentioned, and therefore his priesthood goes on in perpetuity, meaning continuously, right? Now, I don't think that the author nor Genesis is saying that Melchizedek is like the Son of God in that he's actually eternal. I think it's just saying that the Word of God is silent on his genealogy. And so the testimony is he sets an example of one who is like what Jesus ultimately fulfills for us. That's why the end of verse 3 says, in this way he's become like the Son of God, even though he's not the Son of God. But the bigger point that the author is making, and don't miss this, is that Melchizedek is greater than even the patriarch Abraham. Now, why is that significant? Well, the title of the book tells us he's writing to Hebrews. He's writing to the Jews. And so from their perspective, in some ways, there was no one greater than Abraham, Father Abraham. But to say that this one was greater than Abraham in some ways shows that whatever his ministry was supersedes that they had in their heredity as being a Jew. Now, there's two ways that the author points out here that Melchizedek was greater than Abraham. Number one, Abraham paid tithes to him. The Old Testament law says that the Levites would receive tithes, but only from their brothers. But Melchizedek wasn't related to Abraham, yet he received tithes from him. But the one that's perhaps the real kicker is that Melchizedek blessed Abraham. And it's testimony that the lesser doesn't bless the greater. That wouldn't make sense. But the greater blesses who? The lesser. So Melchizedek is greater than Abraham. What he's really getting at, and the bigger point, is that actually Melchizedek's priesthood is greater than the Old Testament priesthood. And if his priesthood is greater than the Old Testament priesthood, then Melchizedek is even greater than the Old Testament high priest. Well, how do we know that? Where he emphasizes it the most is that in their great-grandfather, Abraham, before the tribe of Levi was ever born or established, when they were still in the body of their patriarch, Abraham, in a sense, when Abraham paid tithes to Melchizedek, guess who else paid tithes to Melchizedek? The priest who would come. So he was greater than even them. Now, we stop there for just a moment and go, well, that's all. I mean, I think I can probably, I can carry on an interesting conversation at a party. I have a conversation starter at a party. Hey, you guys heard about Melchizedek. But you might say, how in the world does that help us today with the question of inadequacy or hopelessness? How does this answer that question? How does this somehow give us a better hope? Because in Jesus' perpetual priesthood that was like Melchizedek's, we see in verses 11 through 22, ultimately that leads to a greater guarantee for us. Listen to verses 11 through 22. This is really the crux of this passage. Now, if perfection was through the Levitical priesthood, for on the basis of it people received the law, what further need was there for another priest to arise according to the order of Melchizedek and not designated according to the order of Aaron? For when the priesthood is changed, of necessity there takes place a change of the law also. For the one concerning whom these things are spoken belongs to another tribe, from which no one has officiated at the altar. For it is evident that our Lord was descended from Judah, a tribe with reference to which Moses spoke nothing concerning priest. And this is clear still. If another priest arises according to the likeness of Melchizedek, who has become such not on the basis of the law of physical requirements, but according to the power of an indestructible life, for it's attested of him, you are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. For on the one hand, there is a setting aside of the former commandment because of its weakness and uselessness. For the law made nothing perfect. And on the other hand, there's a bringing in of a better hope through which we draw near to God. And inasmuch as it was not without an oath, for they indeed became priests without an oath, but he with an oath through the one who said to him, "The Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever." So much the more also Jesus has become the guarantee of a better covenant. To understand what he's saying about Jesus and why that matters to us, we need at least a basic understanding of what the role of the law and the priest were. In some ways, right, the law is given so that man, as long as he is obeying it, is in fellowship with God, and access to God remains open. In some ways, that's really the crux of the book of Hebrews. How do we maintain? How is it that access to God and his throne in the world in which we live and the difficulties that we face, how is it that access to God remains open? Well, as long as you obey the law, you're in fellowship with God, and that access remains open. The problem is, hear me say this, no one could keep the law. And so what that meant is our righteousness is undone, and the way to God is shut off. Well, in step the second component, the priesthood. Priests were there so that when the law wasn't met, atonement, sacrifices could be made so that the people were put back in relationship with God, and to say it this way, and the way to God would be opened back up. As a matter of fact, the Latin word for priest, pontifex, means bridge builder, essentially. So priests were intended to be bridge builders between people and God to keep the way to God open. Now listen, that system is not evil. It's not like that system is immoral. It's just that that system, because of us and the priest, had a fatal flaw to begin with. In other words, the problem with it isn't that it's evil. The problem with it is it could never bring about righteousness and keep open the way to God, which is why in verses 11 and 15, a rhetorical question is asked. Well, if the former priest actually could make things right, then why in the world did there have to be another priest in the order not of Aaron but Melchizedek come about, if indeed righteousness could be achieved this way through the law? And the answer is because it couldn't. And we know it couldn't, which is why Jesus was brought in, not in the order of Aaron or the Old Testament priest, but a whole different order. Now look at verse 12. This is important as well when you think about both of those aspects, the priest and the law. Look at verse 12. It says, not only did there have to be a different order of priests, but the law itself had to change. Well, why is that? Well, we'll see in just a moment, because Jesus doesn't actually become a priest based on the law. He's not, in fact, serving as a priest the way the Old Testament law points out, because the Old Testament priesthood was almost completely based on lineage. In other words, you had to trace your line back to Levi. That's the only way you could serve as a priest. Well, there's a problem. Jesus did not come from the tribe of Levi. He came from the tribe of Judah, which according to the Old Testament law, no one from the tribe of Judah was ever allowed or spoken of serving the altar. Which leads us to ask the question, then on what basis, on whose authority is Jesus allowed to be our high priest? Well, the author of Hebrews answers that quite simply through David's writing of Psalm 110, specifically verse 4. Because David, who wrote perhaps as much as 400 years after the Mosaic Law, says messianically that there must be another priest in the order of this Melchizedek. So if we can say it quite simply like this, what gives Jesus the authority, the right, the validity to be our high priest, not like the others, but a completely different one, which will become important for us, what gives him this authority? Quite simply, it is God's word itself. It is God's proclamation that gave Jesus the right to be a high priest of a different order. And God's proclamation has, if I can say it this way, two components to it. Number one, Psalm 110 shows us that Jesus has an indestructible life. God's word says that Jesus has an indestructible life. Verses 16, 15 and 16. And this is clearer still, if another priest arises according to the likeness of Melchizedek, who has become such not on the basis of a law of physical requirements, but according to the power of an indestructible life, for it is attested of him, you are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. The second part to God's proclamation giving Jesus the authority to be a high priest is not just his indestructible life, but again, based on Psalm 110, but the oath that God made concerning Jesus. Look, beginning in verses 20 and 21. Inasmuch as it was not without an oath, for they indeed became priests without an oath, but he with an oath through the one who said to him, the Lord has sworn and will not change his mind, you are a priest forever. So Jesus' indestructible life and God's oath concerning Jesus is what validates and gives Jesus the authority to our high priest. And the point is, in none of the other, there's not a single one of the other Old Testament priests that those two things can be said of them. Now this is why that becomes so important. Because there's three outcomes in our life as a result of Jesus becoming this high priest like Melchizedek. First of all, look at verse 18. The former commandments are set aside because they're weak and useless, because the law never could make anyone perfect. Now, the word that's used here is not the word abolish. Jesus himself says, I didn't abolish the law, I fulfilled it. So in what manner was it set aside? As a means to make anyone right with God and a means to keep access to God open. It would never do. And when Jesus becomes priest, those things are set aside because they would never work and get the job done to begin with. But the good news is, secondly, not only do we set aside the former commandments, verse 19, but Jesus brings in, replaces the former commandments with a better hope through which we have access to God. I'm going to tell on us, Brett. Brett and I, on I always give Brett my title for my sermon on Mondays. And usually it's like 401. He wants it at 4. It's like 401 because I'm so indecisive. And the name of this sermon is A Better Hope. And you'll understand why in a moment. We kind of laughed back and forth about a cultural reference. And I told him it was everything I can do, and some of you in the room might get this, to not name it A New Hope. But Jesus brings in a better hope. And the great news, and this is an emphasis in the book of Hebrews, right? It's not the issue in Hebrews isn't just our right standing before God, but the issue in Hebrews is how do I maintain a audience with God? How do I continually have access to God when things in this world almost daily, if not hourly, seem to go wrong? Well, it's this new hope that ultimately ushers in not just my righteousness before God, but the invitation to continue to approach boldly the throne of God. Which leads, if you will, in verse 22, the final outcome that Jesus' priesthood brings about in our life, not just the setting aside of the former commandments and bringing in this new hope, but watch this. Jesus himself becomes the guarantee of a better covenant. The word guarantee is perhaps better translated as a legal term, surety. Jesus is the surety of a better covenant. It's used, we think, in that day and time to be that which secures a woman's dowry or is often put down for bail. In other words, it's a legal term that is legally guaranteeing that something will occur. Jesus is the guarantor and guarantee of this new covenant. Now, what about this term covenant? What about it? What do we do with that? The word covenant in Hebrews, perhaps if I could describe it, is something like this. It's a promise or an agreement in which mankind, humanity, is invited into fellowship with God and promised the treasures of grace and the inheritance of heaven. Jesus is this better covenant. Jesus brings about this better hope. In 1977, the first Star Wars, you guessed it, titled A New Hope, hit the screens. Now, what's fascinating, if you know anything about Star Wars, even though it was the first one released, it was actually Episode 4. Now, why was it Episode 4 and why was it called A New Hope? Well, because later we learned that there's actually three stories or three episodes that come before it in which we meet Luke's father, Anakin, who in some ways was supposed to be the original hope, bring balance to the Force and defeat the Sith, the evil Sith. Unfortunately, Anakin failed and was overtaken by the dark side. In step Luke in A New Hope. Now, maybe Luke's not the only new hope in Star Wars Episode 4, but all those themes of hope kind of find their impetus or centrality in the character of Luke. There's a real sense in which the glimmer of light is shown to have hung on and not have been completely overtaken by dark and darkness, and a new generation represented in a son steps forward to complete and overcome the failures of the previous generation. It's not that there was necessarily anything more wrong with a priest than any of the rest of us. But the Old Testament legal system and the priest, as far as to make one righteous, failed. It could never do that. But our new hope, Jesus as a son, brings about and overcomes what those in the Old Testament for us and his people could never do. So why is it that we ultimately have this new covenant and we have this new hope? Well, look very quickly at verses 23 through 28. It's because of the superior son. Listen. The former priest, on the one hand, existed in greater number because they were prevented by death from continuing. But Jesus, on the other hand, because he continues forever, holds his priesthood permanently. Therefore, he is able also to save forever those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercessions for them. For it was fitting for us to have such a high priest, holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens, who does not need daily, like those high priests, to offer up sacrifices, first for his own sins, and then for the sins of the people, because this he did once for all when he offered up himself. For the law appoints men as high priests who are weak, but the word of the oath which came after the law appoints a son made perfect forever. I don't have to tell you this. I don't have to say this to you, but I will. You understand that any salvation, any hope, any faith that you would possess that's based on a person is doomed to collapse. Because those people just like you, just like me, are imperfect and they'll disappoint you. This is true of anyone. It's true of a pastor, right? We've seen public displays of pastors failing morally, but let's just be honest. Even the pastors that don't have some major moral failing, at some point they're going to disappoint you. I'm going to disappoint you. That's probably not what you wanted to hear from your pastor. I'm going to disappoint you at some point if I haven't already. Why? Because I'm human and I'm imperfect. So don't base your hope of salvation and right standing and access to God on me. It's true of any man. It will eventually collapse. And it was true of the priest. It's not that they were inherently evil. It's just that they could never sustain a faith and an access to the Father. The system was fatally flawed. The text ends by telling us in at least two ways. Number one, those priests were mortal. Look at verse 23. The former priest, on the one hand, existed in greater numbers because they were prevented by death from continuing. Translation, there was a whole bunch of them, which sounds like a good thing. But the reason for there being a whole bunch of them is not a good thing, because they die. And at some point, you're going to have to replace them. They can't hold the office forever. That's one of the weaknesses of the priesthood of the Old Testament. There's a second one. The text tells us in verse 27, 28, they were weak. Weak men were appointed. Now, in context, it's talking about sinful men. They sin just like you, just like me. Look at verses 27 and 28. Who does not need daily, like those high priests, to offer up sacrifices, first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people, because he did this once for all when he offered up himself. For the law appoints men as high priests who are weak. The system was flawed. They are flawed. They have two fatal flaws from day one that our faith can't be built on. Well, that sounds really pessimistic, Pastor. Jesus, the divine Son, does not himself, and this is the point, own either of those fatal flaws. Just look at the end of verse 28 for a moment. The law appoints weak men, but through an oath, a son was appointed, who has been made perfect forever. Perhaps the most important qualification for Jesus as our high priest that puts us in right relationship with God and keeps access to God's throne room open, the greatest and most important qualification of Jesus is that he is a son in a way that no one else is, and he's the eternal son. Jesus is not mortal. In other words, Jesus has a perpetual priesthood, and he doesn't have to hand the office off to someone else. He keeps it forever. Verse 24. Therefore, Jesus, on the one hand, because he continues forever, holds his priesthood permanently. And the second flaw, men's weakness or sinfulness, we read in verses 26 and 27 that Jesus is completely distinct and different than sinners. For it was fitting, it was necessary for us to have such a high priest, holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners and exalted above the heavens, who did not need to stand daily ministering, offering sacrifices for himself and then other people, because he himself had no sin. What this leads to, the outcome, the main point of this passage, I believe, is verse 25. The outcome in our life, where the crux of Hebrews chapter 7 finds its location, is Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25. I understand it's a little bit of a cliche, but when we see a therefore in Scripture, we should ask what it is. Therefore. Therefore, he is able also to save forever. Why? Because he holds his priesthood forever, and he is not weak. He is not a sinner. He's able to save forever, eternally, those who draw near to God. So it's in Jesus and his priesthood that our salvation is eternal. But look at the end of verse 25. There's something else. Remember, the issue is not just coming to God in the first place, but having access to God, remaining open. And save forever those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercessions for them. Jesus' validity as our high priest makes our salvation eternal and perpetually keeps our access to the very throne of God open, to where we're not only allowed to come to God, but we're invited to come to God. If I can go back to the original thought for just a moment, it is in Jesus, it is in him that all of our inadequacies and our hopelessness disappear. So as a spiritual principle, here's what we see. We have an assurance of a better hope by which we draw near to God, because Jesus, as the Son, as the divine Son, possesses an eternal and perfect high priesthood. And because of this, there are three applications that I want you to hear before we go. For all who are in Christ, here are three applications. Stop worrying about your salvation. Perhaps there's no passage in all of the New Testament that shows us, for those that are truly in Christ, because he saves us forever and lives to make intercession of us, that shows us that our salvation in him is secure and cannot be lost or taken. Stop worrying about your salvation if you're in Christ. Number two, stop wondering of whether or not you have access to the Father. Not only do you have access if you want it, but you are commanded to boldly approach his throne of grace in your time or hour of need to find timely help. So stop wondering. Know for certain in Christ, your high priest who lives to make intercession for you, that you indeed do. And maybe thirdly, one we don't often think about, stop waiting to share this hope with others who need this hope as well. If this is indeed the way of the Father and how our access is maintained, we are the advocates and the representatives that need to share it with others. I had the occasion one time about, 10 or 15 years ago to go do a youth disciple weekend at North Augusta, South Carolina, which is right across the border from Augusta, Georgia, which is where one of the most famous golf courses in the world is located, Augusta National, where every spring they play the Masters Tournament. I'm a big golf fan, so the guy that was hosting me picked me up from the airport, drove me up Washington Avenue, and I got to get out of the car and look up like this, Magnolia Lane. that's close as I got. Well, why? Because they won't let you pass the guard shack. Even to go to the clubhouse and take pictures, if you're not a member, you don't have an invitation, or you don't have some type of ticket. I, in that moment, was completely inadequate. I had no hope of success in that moment. This is the honest to goodness truth. The closest I got was playing putt-putt across the road. It's a true story. It's interesting about that part of the country. There are luscious and luxurious golf courses all over the place. The reason why, there's all these people that have a lot of money but never were allowed to become members or even play Augusta National. So they built their own golf course. Now, they're nice, but none of them are Augusta. As a matter of fact, at any given time, Augusta National only has about 300 members. And to become a member, it really doesn't matter how much money you have. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what your name is or who your daddy is to some extent. The only way to become a member of Augusta National is you have to be invited. Listen, when we try on our own to gain access to the very throne room of God, we are standing on holy ground and we are completely inadequate. We have no hope. We're out of place. But through Jesus, the perpetual high priest, the eternal Son of God, and His invitation, not only do we have hope, but we have certainty, and we are absolutely in Him in the right place. Perhaps this is pictured very well in the first verse of the modern hymn Before the Throne of God that was made popular by the group several years ago, Selah. Maybe you remember the lyrics. Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. A great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands. My name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. No tongue can bid me thence depart. Amen, amen, amen. I pray that is your hope and your certainty today. And if not, it can be. Would you pray with me? As we think about moving into a time of response and invitation today, let me just ask you, if you're here today and you've never trusted Christ, the great high priest, for your righteousness before the Father, would you do that today? I'll be standing here. I'd love to talk with you and pray with you about that. Or maybe you're here today and you are a believer, but you've just been trying to do this life, the things that come at you in this world on your own. Listen, Jesus has made open to you access to the very throne room of God. Would you just look to Him today and trust the hope that He's already given you? Let's pray. When we say amen, we're going to stand and respond as we sing. Gracious Father, thank You so much, as always, for Your Word. Thank You for its truth. But even more than that, thank You so much for Jesus and the gospel it teaches us of. Thank You that we indeed have a high priest that is interceding for us right now at Your very right hand. Help us to trust, help us to know, help us to feel confident about the hope, the salvation, and access to You that we have through Him. And it's in Your name that we give You and pray these things. Amen and amen.
Who else commands all the hosts of heaven? Who else can make every king bow down? Who else can whisper and darkness trembles? Only a holy God. What other beauty demands such praises? What other splendor outshines the sun?
Thank you all for being here today. What a fantastic day we've had in worship. I really appreciate it. Pastor Adams' takeaways, they were very, very good. Those applications at the end, I appreciate them. They hit home to me. It was also cool to hear you guys applaud in the middle of his message. I think I've spoken maybe 25 times here. No one's applauded in the middle of my message. But a couple times at the end of my message, you guys applauded. I know, so. Hey, if you're here and you want a follow-up, we're easy to find. We are available to you. So if you would like to have another conversation, I'll be down here. I think Adam's in the front. You can also text Connect to that number up there, and we will be sure and get back with you. Our benediction comes to us from Psalm 52, where David writes, "I will praise thee forever, because thou hast done it, and I will wait on thy name. For it is good before thy saints." Amen. Have a great Sunday.